Come with us on a journey back through time and culture. This film tells the untold stories surrounding Freddie Mercury, casting light on the man behind the music and tracing his strangely unpublicized roots to exotic shores. Though only a tiny speck in the atlas, Zanzibar casts long, mysterious shadows across the imagination. Whether the 1950s reality of this old Arab trading post matched the perceived glamour of Sinbad, sultans, slaves and spices is, of course, another matter. And when it comes to throwing light on those early days, no one alive could possibly surpass this guide.
I'm Jill Balsara, Freddie's mummy.
Nothing in Zanzibar acknowledges or celebrates the importance of Freddie Mercury, a situation that artist John De Silva, an elder school friend of Freddie's, would like to see rectified.
There must be something, a kind of a plaque or something like that on Freddie Mercury. I think Freddie has built himself up so well, and that impact is certainly, Zanzibar would certainly gain from that.
I'm Cash Cook, Freddie's sister.
It's very tropical, beautiful beaches, beautiful sea, very hot. And that's exactly what it is. Unspoilt, dirty, smelly. It's all right as a holiday place, but not to live in, I'm afraid.
He was born on 5th September 1946. And
he throws where the Bulsaras flew in to escape from the 1964 uprising in Zanzibar. Like many an immigrant mother, Jair Bulsara came with nothing but hope.
It was very hard in the beginning, and I had told my children, it's not going to be easy, we all have to work together. But they did agree and they did listen. I just wanted Freddie to become a lawyer or an accountant or something like that.
But Freddie didn't share his mum's dream of a white-collar life. After hearing Jimi Hendrix, he wanted rock and roll as a day job. He went to art school, met new friends Brian May and Roger Taylor, and opened a stall in Kensington Market.
We decided we'd take the plunge. And it was then I sort of thought about the name Queen. You know, I had it in the back of my mind. I thought one day, you know, that could be, we could put that to good use.
Why Queen?
I don't know. At the time, it was outrageous. The name lent itself to a lot of things, a lot of the theatre and the kind of things that we wanted to do.
We had a lot of what we thought were good songs, and we were rehearsing ourselves up. We were sort of ready for it, but we couldn't find the door to walk through. Yeah. So one day, this chap turned up, who's a friend of a friend, basically, working at Delane Lee Studios, the new Delane Lee Studios in Wembley, which was just being built, and they were testing the acoustics. And he said to me, we need a group to come in here and make some noise so that we can test all our lines and the soundproofing and whatever. And in return, we will make some tracks.
We had one demo tape on a little reel, and Fred and I were on the train to Wembley on some sort of desperate mission to try and flog this tape to another record company. And it was a hard slog round, you know. It didn't come overnight, but then suddenly, when it did happen, it like sort of accelerated, yeah.
So how long before the album came out was it recorded and finished?
Hard to remember. I'd say about a good year. Mm. it took so long, from the time of actually making those tapes. It's just quite unbelievable. I mean, the material was so old as far as we were concerned by then. Mm. Well, I loved a million women in a Belladonna case, and I had a million dinners brought to me on silver tray.
I think it was the first song that we actually wrote ourselves ever as Queen. I mean, there's a couple of things we tried before that when Roger and I were in Smile, but I think this is the first sort of Queen song.
Well, we get a call at any time of day or night, and usually middle of the night. You know, it was basically it was the off time of the studio. It was when the studio had dead time and nobody was in. But we would sort of grab those hours and regard them as sort of gold dust.
We've got Deacon John on bass.
As I remember it, John Anthony, our producer at the time, so he thought Deacon John sounded rather mysterious and good. And I think Deaky sort of went, well, I don't know, whatever. And then when it appeared on the album, he didn't like it. He said, no, I'm John Deacon, and I would prefer to be John Deacon.
We were in our management offices, and Fred just says, oh, by the way, I'm changing my name. And we said, really? What to? You know, I'm going to be Freddie Mercury.
And he started wearing wings on his trousers. It was a sure sign something was going on. In those days, it was kind of cool to just stand there and play your instrument and ignore the audience. But Freddie was always, no, we should present, we should connect, we should be dramatic, you know, we should get the material across. And of course he was right.